All right, good morning everyone. Welcome to this overview of mechatronics engineering. My name is Luke Hallam. I'm a senior lecturer in the Department of Mechanical Engineering. I teach into the third and the fourth years of our mechatronics program, and I'm also involved in teaching and research in mechatronics at the postgraduate level. So my research concerns topics that sit at the interface of medicine and engineering, and that's where you'll find much of the mechatronics research that goes on here at the University of Auckland. So let's begin with the basics. Mechanical engineering is one of the oldest disciplines, oldest and most well-established disciplines in engineering. It deals with the design, construction, and the use of machines. Electronics is around 100 years younger than mechanical engineering. Electronics deals with that part of science and technology comprising circuits, transistors, and microchips. So if we collide these two terms at high speed, what we end up with is mechatronics. Mechatronics is an interdisciplinary area that integrates mechanical systems with computer hardware and software for the purposes of control. So the way that I often think about it is like this. Mechatronics is concerned with computations, either hardware or software, that exist in the service of things that typically move. So, mechatronics is a hot topic. How hot, you ask? Let me show you just precisely how hot it is. So this was a third year project. Third year project in which students were asked to design, build, and test a firefighting robot. So the task at hand was to put out three fires in the field. Those candles could be positioned anywhere. And the robot had to avoid obstacles in the process of doing so. Let me show you another example. Safer world indeed. You get the feeling that some of our students are pretty good at marketing as well. Okay. But training robots to break wind in the right direction is not all that we do in mechatronics. In fact, robotics is just a small part of what we do. The truth is that most modern mechanical devices are mechatronic devices. So, most motor vehicles, the bread and butter of mechanical engineering, now integrate sophisticated sensing and actuating, and more generally, sophisticated control systems. Household appliances are becoming smarter than we are, and even more internet-enabled than we are. Listening to a podcast last night, I learned that 25% of the dollars spent now on vacuum cleaners are spent on robotic vacuum cleaners. And iRobot, which is the major seller of vacuum cleaners in the United States, has now sold something like 20 to 25 million devices. Computer parts and peripherals are mechatronic. For example, disk drives, inkjet printers, and haptic devices, in other words, game controllers for your gaming platform. Mechatronic systems are centrally important to industry. Industrial robots are on the rise. Machine tools and CNC milling devices are becoming ever more sophisticated. Medical imaging systems are mechatronic systems, and increasingly medical devices are mechatronic systems as well. For example, surgical robots. Indeed, most modern products integrate computers or microprocessors for sensing, actuation, and control. So this diagram shows the relationship of mechatronics to the larger fields in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics of control systems, electronic systems, mechanical systems, and computers. And around the circumference, you'll see a partial list of industries where mechatronics graduates of ours are likely to find themselves in the years following their graduation. So, for example, the automotive industry, the medical industry, manufacturing, and aerospace, and so on. So here at the University of Auckland, our mechatronics interests are diverse. To name just a few, we're interested in acoustic signals, we're interested in quadcopters, medical devices for rehabilitation, artificial organs, we're interested in robotics, 3D printing, as well as biological and artificial neural networks for sensing, actuation, and control. So what I'm going to do over the course of the next 10 minutes is take you through some examples drawn from both mechatronics coursework, but also mechatronics research that goes on here at the University of Auckland. So here I'm about to show you a video that illustrates work done by two of my colleagues, Mike Kingen and Yushka Hayoka. Mike is interested in acoustics, especially he's interested in acoustics surrounding aircraft. And Yushka is interested in the processing of signals, especially in the separation of acoustic signals from ambient acoustic noise. So what you're seeing here is the view from a camera that is mounted beneath a quadcopter. At the top of frame, you can see an array. Well, you have a partial view of an array of microphones, okay? And this inset image here is a third-person display of what's going on. This is Mike Kingen, one of the academics involved in this work. And what you're hearing at the moment is the acoustic signal recorded from the microphone that is integrated with the camera that gives us this large frame picture. It's noisy.
Kit contains rotors which are 10 decibels quieter than current standard rotor designs. The hush kit also incorporates a microphone array and signal processing software which can be used to significantly reduce the unwanted UAV noise.
So there are two things going on here in this collaboration between Mike and Yushka. The first involves the design of rotors that reduce the noise produced by this quadcopter. And the second involves the use of signal processing and this array of microphones so that the drone is better able to monitor noises going on in the environment. So there are potentially myriad applications of work like this. One would be the automated monitoring of cattle and other livestock in remote, hard-to-get-to areas. The microphone array that was depicted in that previous video is shown here on the left. It actually comprises 7 microphones, and it's also being put to experimental use for the monitoring of the location and number of the endangered kiwi in forests in and around the Auckland region. So here in this next video, I'll illustrate some of the work done by Dr. Carl Stoll and his colleagues. So again, this work involves a quadcopter, and what's been done here is a system has been designed, implemented, and shown here as a test. So the quadcopter will follow at a safe distance an object that it's been programmed to sense, in this case, the red ball. It's enough to scare a horse away. So the beauty of this work is that it's a mashup of sensing and control. Some of that sensing is of the sort that you would expect in an aeronautic system, and other of that sensing is video sensing. I know that was a close call, wasn't it? Other of that sensing is video sensing. So it really is a nice piece of engineering done by these fourth year students as part of their honors project. Of course, obstacle avoidance is something that this drone has to quote-unquote think about as well, and sometimes it gets it right. All right, so in our real-time software paper this year, which is one of our third-year papers, we discussed the fiasco at Boeing, inferring what we could about their software failures from information that was present in the public domain. So for those who haven't heard about the fiasco, pictured here is a Boeing 737 MAX 8. The MAX 8 has been involved in 2 fatal accidents over the last 12 months, one in Indonesia and one in Ethiopia. And although investigations are ongoing, it seems that the failure of a real-time software control system sits as the root cause for both of these crashes. So on either side of the MAX 8, you find an angle of attack sensor, like this here. There are 2 of them, one on either side. So the angle of attack, my aeronautics colleagues would get upset with me, but the angle of attack is basically the pitch of the aircraft. So that's a high angle of attack, that's a low angle of attack, and the way that the control systems on board, and indeed the crew, know what the angle of attack of the aircraft is by looking at these sensor readings. Now, the real-time software control system in question is designed to push the nose of the airplane down if it determines that the angle of attack is too high. So it does so in an attempt to stop the aircraft from stalling. This is a new control system that was implemented with the MAX 8. It was implemented with the MAX 8 because the engines under the wings are larger than previous generations of the Boeing 737. The engines had to be set back a little, and that changed the center of mass of the aircraft, necessitating this control system. So this is a graph that shows some of the last minutes of the flight that crashed in Indonesia. So what we're plotting on the y-axis here is vertical velocity, vertical speed, and on the x-axis, we're plotting time. So in our real-time software paper this year, we discussed how the control system, the software control system in question, handled poorly a failed angle of attack sensor. We then went on to discuss the tremendous benefit of having threefold redundancy in the sensors that decorate your aircraft and computational ways of robustly inferring the sense that is returned to the control system by your peripheral devices. So in this video, I'm going to show you some telemanipulation. Again, this was a fourth year honors project.
That looks good. Nice.
So what's happening there is Lucy is using those two haptic devices to control the two industrial robotic arms. Okay, now this mapping of human motion to robot motion has many potential applications. For example, unfortunately I'm going to have to start this from the beginning, but for example, you can imagine that you may be interested in performing manipulations in dangerous environments.
That looks good.
Or in environments that are hard to get to. Part of the task here for Lucy is to learn to use a new set of arms.
Yay!
The crowd of one goes wild.
That's beautiful.
In another of last year's fourth year honors projects, Hui Jiang and Rebecca Chen developed a new probe that uses light to analyze the biomolecular structure of tissues of the human body. So the application in mind here is to make an improvement over traditional biopsy techniques for the diagnosis of cancer. So on the left, what I'm showing you is a CAD drawing of the tip of the probe that is inserted into the body. This shows a benchtop test of the probe being applied to, I think, what is a globule of fat from a piece of meat which was brought down at the butcher. And then on the right, what I'm showing you is a machine learning algorithm that Hui and Rebecca developed to analyze the light signals that were measured by this probe. And the particular task here was to take those light signals and attempt to classify them in such a way as to distinguish what they're calling high-grade tumor, which I think might be malignant tumor, distinguish that from low-grade tumor, which I think might be benign tumor, and in turn to distinguish both of those from normal tissue. So this is a low-dimensional representation of the very high-dimensional optical signals that are recorded by this probe that they designed when it's inserted in tissue, potentially cancerous tissue. And in this last video here, I'm going to show you the way that you can gamify your stroke rehabilitation. So this is a student of Professor Andrew McDade's. And what he's doing is he's interacting with an exoskeleton, and that exoskeleton in turn is interacting with a flight simulator on a laptop computer. So what he's trying to do is to play this game by manipulating the exoskeleton. And the idea is that manipulation of devices like these can help people who have been affected by stroke. It can help them get through their prescribed regimen of exercises that will bring their nervous system, parts of their nervous system and their muscles, back to a state of improved functioning. So most of our alumni graduate after 4 years with a Bachelor of Engineering Honours in Mechatronics Engineering. In other words, a BE Honours. As an undergraduate, you'll work alongside many other engineers, perhaps first and foremost those who are working towards a mechanical engineering degree. But mechatronics is a research active area, and so therefore undergrads have ample opportunity to interact with graduate students who are working towards either a Master's of Engineering, a Master's of Engineering Studies with a specialization in medical devices and technologies, or a PhD.
I'm worried about little Dilbert. He's not like other kids.
What do you mean?
Yesterday, I left him alone for a minute, and he disassembled the TV, our clock, and the stereo.
That's perfectly normal. Kids take things apart.
Ooh! The part that worries me is he used the components to build a ham radio set.
Oh, dear.
Is that bad?
Normally, I'd want to run an EEG on him, but the machine isn't working. It's worse than I feared.
What is it?
I'm afraid your son has the knack.
The knack?
The knack. It's a rare condition characterized by an extreme intuition about all things mechanical and electrical, and utter social ineptitude.
Can he lead a normal life?
No. He'll be an engineer.
No!
There. Don't blame yourself.
Well, it...
To the parents in the room, don't blame yourselves. Send us your problem children. So career prospects are very good for our graduates. Our alumni are involved in the design, build, and implementation of a wide range of products and processes. Throughout our four-year mechatronics program, we don't just emphasize technical skills, we also emphasize communication skills, both written and spoken skills, and we emphasize teamwork. And this often lands our graduates in management roles at quite early stages in their career, if that's where they want to go. So our graduates are valued for their analytic skills, their teamworking ability, and their problem solving. Potential employers come from a range of different industries, including the robotics and industrial automation industry, the medical and healthcare engineering industry, consultancy industry, manufacturing, and the software and IT industry. So there are excellent challenges and opportunities in a wide range of fields for our mechatronics graduates. We develop a broad base of expertise, and what we foster in our students is a sort of a whole technology problem-solving ability. And students go forth into the world and generally find opportunities to apply their skills in innovation and to solve major problems. So that's all I have for you. Thank you very much for listening, and I'm going to hang around at the end of this lecture for 10 minutes to answer any questions. If you have any, please come up and chat with me. Thanks again.